as you go throughout life. Your songs can help and encourage it. Amen?
Yep.
All right. Well, we're glad you're here tonight. We're looking forward to seeing what God's going to do tonight for us. Amen?
Amen.
And so we had a tremendous night last night. And had some different preachers here in the service and some different guests with us. Had a good crowd here tonight. And it seems like perfect, another night of beautiful weather.
Amen.
Now, I've been told the humidity is supposed to come back a little bit tomorrow, but don't let that scare you, okay? So we'll still be right here, 7 o'clock, we'll start. And just excited to see what God's doing. Man, the messages last night were tremendous, weren't they?
Amen.
I tell you, all week long, it's just been something. And the music has been a blessing. And so we're excited about what the Lord's going to do tonight. So let's bow our heads for prayer. Ask God to bless the service tonight. Let me say this before we pray. If you're visiting with us, we do have some water bottles if you need them. We're back there in that cooler. We have restrooms over here because it's kind of different. I try to just explain this to everybody every night. If you need to get into your vehicle for some reason, you can sit in your vehicle like with a child. Maybe a little bit noisy or something like that. Feel free to get in your vehicle. Tune into 104.1. Then you can listen to that. And so, won't we bow our head for prayer and ask God to bless the service here tonight? Let's bow for prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for tonight. We're thankful, Lord, for what you've done in our hearts all so far this week. God, thank you for the messages and what you did on Sunday, how you blessed on Monday. God, how you worked in a mighty way on Tuesday. And Lord, here we are tonight. We need to hear from heaven. And so, God, we pray that you would just use every aspect of the service here tonight. And God, you'd use it to minister to our hearts. You'd use it to help us to become more like Christ. That it would encourage us and strengthen us and revive us. Help us, God, to get right with you. Help us, Lord, to make decisions. And Lord, if there is somebody here tonight that doesn't know Christ as their Savior, I pray that tonight will be the night they come to know Christ. And so, God, I pray that you bless them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand, take our songbook, Psalm 439, Psalm 439, Dwelling in Beulah Land. We'll sing all four verses of Psalm 439, Dwelling in Beulah Land.
Far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling.
Moving from
good. So you turn to Psalm 363. Psalm 363, saved by the blood. Psalm 363. Sing all four verses of Psalm 363, saved by the blood of the crucified.
Well,
ladies did a great job, didn't they?
Yeah!
Now, I don't know if you know this or not, all but one of those ladies is married. Okay? We have some guys up here that sing, all those guys that sing up here, all but one is married. I'm not trying to hang around or anything. Maybe that's a second guy. Right? Huh? Moms are saying, huh? Oh, all of the love got mixed up? Yeah. So I get things mixed up too. My jokes get mixed up too. All the girls up there, right? There's only one of them that's married, right? And all these guys up here, there's only one of them that's married, right? Yeah. No, I'm not hitting around or anything, all right? I did notice through social media, though, that when Sam, when Sam was here last time, he was single. And then when Cody was here last time, he was single. And I said after you left Delaware, then you ended up getting girlfriends or something, it looked like, on social media. And I said, well, all because he came to God's country, that's why. The good old Eastern Shore, that's something to you, all right? All right. Well, we're glad you're here tonight, and let's have some testimonies. Anybody got any testimonies? God glorifying testimonies. It's mostly our church folks here tonight. Let's have some God glorifying testimonies. Anybody have anything? Maybe camp meeting's been a blessing to you. Go ahead. Yeah, Mike, right there.
So I just want to thank Lord for this week and all that He's done in my heart. And today we went out with the teens, and I got to witness to a lady that was in a clothing store, and we talked for a little bit, and I went through the whole plan of salvation, and she said, well, I asked her if she would be willing to, ask the Lord to save her, and she was very receptive, she listened the whole entire time, she was just in on our conversation, and I asked her if she would be willing to pray, and ask Jesus to come into her heart, and she said, well, I don't think I'd be in a position where I could do that right now. And I showed her Proverbs 27:1, and I said, we never know what's going to happen. I said, if I were to go out here and get hit by a car and die, I would go to heaven. But where would you go? And she said, I wouldn't go to heaven. So I told her, I said, what's holding you back? I said, the Bible says today is the appointed time. Today is the day you're supposed to, the process that salvation is today. And I said, so what's holding you back? And as soon as I said that, the phone rang. So she did not end up getting saved, but if you guys could pray for her, it was Kara. But it was just a good opportunity to go out and share the gospel. I'm thankful for that. Thankful that the messages have been a help to me this week, and just lighting a fire in my heart, and just praying that I would go out, and thankful
for that. Okay. I hear you right. You went out soul winning in a clothing store.
Did you say that? Is that what I heard?
You went out, not that you were in a clothing store and you went to be a witness, but you went soul winning in a clothing store. Is that right? Where's my visitation director? You don't send women to a clothing store. Oh, okay. That is reliable. That's what we do. See, you ladies that have missed out on soul winning, we send you to clothing stores. You can find prospects right there and get some discounts as well. All right, anybody else has a testimony? Not glorified testimony. Anybody else? Anybody else? That was a good thing. Nobody else has testimony? Huh? Anybody else? All right, there's one in the back. Let me go get the microphone for you.
I just want to praise the Lord. It's good to be home. It's good to be here. And it's good to be used.
Amen. Anybody else? Hey, testimony. God sent something in your heart this week. Anybody have any testimony? Or God's goodness to you? Something God's done in your life recently? Anybody else? Let the redeemed of the Lord what?
Say so.
That's the testimony. Anybody else?
Pastor, I just want to thank the Lord for you and Miss Tammy and the church. It's been a blessing this week. Everything is just the preaching. I just thank the Lord for the preaching of His Word. The music, all the music's been God honoring. Just a blessing to my soul. So just want to thank you for it.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Pastors, I'll say what's a blessing when I see not only the young ladies, but the young fellows up there singing. And, I knew the mom and daddy before any of them was born. And what's precious is to see Jerry and Lita have allowed God to use them. Life has not always been easy. They've been faithful. Now they've brought up their kids to love and serve the Lord. And that's a precious blessing just to see this as an encouragement, not only encouragement to every family in here.
Amen.
And I'll take it and run with it and realize that, we can bring our kids up in a wretched world to love and serve the Lord. Make a difference.
Good. Praise the Lord. Anybody else have a testimony? Who? Oh, Brother Finger, go ahead.
I just praise the Lord, Brother Harrison's message last night. It just reminded me just how much I need to know about my life.
Amen. Amen. That's good. Anybody else? Anybody else? Don't be shy. All right, go ahead. Oh, stand up. You need to stand up. I think that's a good thing if you stand up. Because you got the door open and just turn around. You're kind of in the middle.
My praise the Lord for all the preaching and all the music has just been stirring me up, and I'm excited for the rest of the week. I don't ever want
to end.
I want to thank, praise the Lord. I guess it was about 4, 5, 6 weeks ago. I went to the doctor and he sent me to a surgeon. And of course, with the surgeon, he's thinking you need surgeons. The surgeon sent me to another doctor, specialist, and I had an appointment this week. And I don't need surgery. I've got some antibiotics and anti-inflammatory that I have to take. But God's still in the healing business.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Anybody else? That's not anybody else. His testimony. She praised her. Yes, go ahead. Stand up. Yes, stand up. This is. Oh, don't make you stand up. All right, this is Haley. She's my friend. She's Maggie's friend, too. First time here last night. What's that? Go ahead.
I just
think the Lord that I've been surrounded by so many amazing and helping people since I've been here. All right, hold on. I couldn't even hear you. So. I'm not trying to embarrass you, though. Go ahead. Say it again, all of you. She says she's just thankful for so many loving and welcome and my people. She's come to church here.
Amen.
We're glad you're here, Haley.
Amen.
She came last night and liked so much. She's back again tonight. I think she's spending the night over at Maddie's house to come tomorrow night. Is that right?
Yep.
All right, good.
Amen.
not gonna going home on Friday. She's from Felton. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. Anybody else have a testimony? All right. Well, we're gonna have our first preacher come for the night, Brother England. It's been a blessing to have him and Christian here.
Amen.
He was with the kids last night. The message tonight will be geared towards families. So all the kids are going to be in here tonight, and we're glad Brother England's here. It's been a blessing to us. See them?
To be here tonight. A privilege to be here each and every time I've been able to. Every single night's been special. I think it's only Wednesday, amen?
We've
got tonight, tomorrow night, Friday night. That's a blessing.
Amen.
Brother Harris, it's been a blessing to share this pulpit with you. It's been my honor to stand behind this pulpit with you and preach the Word of God with you. And I've enjoyed your messages thoroughly. And I do believe God is at work these past couple days. And I want you to take your Bibles and turn to the book of 1 Chronicles, if you would, please. The book of 1 Chronicles. Chapter 22. 1 Chronicles chapter 22, if you would please. We'll look at verses number 1 through 5. First Chronicles chapter number 22, verses 1 through 5. The word of the Lord says here, says, if you would stand with me as we read this passage of Scripture, please. The Bible says here in 1 Chronicles 22, 1 through 5, and David said, "This is the house of the Lord God, and this is the altar of the burnt offering for Israel." And David commanded to gather together the strangers that were in the land of Israel, and he sent masons to hew wrought stones to build the house of God. And David prepared iron in abundance, for the nails for the door of the gates, and for the joinings, and brass in abundance without weight, and cedar trees in abundance. For the Zidonians and they of Tyre brought much cedar wood to David. And I want you to pay attention to this verse right here. And David said, "Solomon, my son is young and tender, and the house that is to be builded for the Lord must be exceeding magnificent, of fame and of glory throughout all countries. I will therefore now make preparation for it." So David prepared abundantly before his death. Tonight I want to preach a message entitled very simply those two words you find in verse number 5, exceeding magnificent. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here once again tonight. And God, we glorify you for what has taken place already under this tabernacle. But God, I know you're not done yet. And I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would just fill this place, that you just take over. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that you just be honored and glorified in this message and all that takes place from here, from this point forward. Thank you, Lord, for your Son. Thank you, Lord, for the blood of Christ. Thank you, Lord, for salvation. Thank you, Lord, for the book. And God, I pray, Lord, that you use this message to glorify you. For we ask it in your name. Amen. Thank you. May you be seated. You find here in 1 Chronicles chapter number 22, David is making his preparations to build a very special place. He was preparing to build the house of the Lord. But David himself was not allowed to build the temple. He needed his son Solomon to build it. David was a man of war, so he was forbidden from building this sacred place. But it didn't stop David from preparing to build the house of the Lord that Solomon was going to build. But those two words that struck me, and those two words we're going to look at tonight, that when David prepared, when David did everything he could before his death to make sure everything was in place that Solomon needed, the Bible says that the house that must be built, it must be exceeding magnificent.
Amen.
But let me ask you a question tonight. What about your life? You think of everything this world has to offer. How are you in the cause of Christ? How are you in your service to God? Are you exceeding magnificent? You see, David knew how important the house of God was. The church is an important place in our lives. It ought to be of the utmost importance to us. When the doors of the house of God are open, guess where we ought to be? In the house of the Lord.
Amen.
David is preparing to build this magnificent building, and he wants it to be done to the best of his ability. He wants it done properly. Nowadays, we come to church.
Right.
We sit in pews.
Come on now.
We open our Bibles.
Right.
We sing the songs. But what is it doing
right
in our lives?
Come on.
Is it making a difference? The Bible says we're supposed to be the salt of the world. We're supposed to be the light of the world. Are we?
Absolutely.
Are we? If we were to put ourselves in a group of lost people, would they be able to pick us out of the crowd? Are we exceeding magnificent for the cause of Christ?
Mm.
Nowadays, the message is just come as you are and leave just the same as you came.
That's right.
The Bible's different, the messages are watered down, the sloppy dress is the standard, the worldly watered down songs are the music, the perversions are the book, and it's all disregarding what it's supposed to be.
Right.
It's supposed to be church!
Right.
Why? Because it's supposed to be exceeding magnificent.
Right.
We ought to give God our very best.
That's right.
Come on.
Sometimes we slap together a few songs, we ask if anyone has a special, we give a 10-minute message, and we shoo everyone out the door. But then we get on our knees and say, "Oh God, would you bring about a revival?" and we wonder why nothing's happening. That's not exceeding magnifico. I guarantee you that when God formed this earth as you see it, when he formed the foundations of the world, I guarantee you when he did it exceeding magnifico. When he breathed life in the breath of man, he did it exceeding magnifico.
Amen.
When he hung the stars in the sky, when he formed the beasts of the field, the fowls of the air, and the fish of the sea, he did it exceeding magnifico.
Amen.
When God prepared a ram for Isaac, he did it exceeding magnifico. When Moses raised up his hands and parted the Red Sea, guess what? He did it exceeding magnifico.
Yes.
When God brought down that manna from heaven, he guided the Israelites through that wilderness. God did it to the best of his ability. Why? See, God, that's what we deserve. He did it exceeding magnifico. When I think about Jesus Christ, that virgin birth, that necessary virgin birth that was needed when Jesus Christ was born. You know what that was? You know what that was God doing? Exceeding magnifico. When Jesus Christ gave his life on the cross of Calvary, and he hung there, he's beaten and scourged and mocked and crucified. Guess what? He said, I'm giving my life. You know why? Because they deserve exceeding magnifico.
Amen.
3 days later, he conquered death and he conquered the grave and rose again and he sealed our salvation.
Right.
Because he gave us something exceeding magnifico. What about our lives? That's everything God has done. From the foundations of the world to now. Everything God does exceeds magnifico. Without fail. But then we're okay with giving God average. I'll give God 50% of my life. I'll give God only a portion. It's okay. I won't go to church. I'll go to church sometime. I'll read my Bible once in a while. I'll pray when I feel like it. Guess what? That's not exceeding magnifico.
Right.
Amen.
My Bible says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
Amen.
And be not conformed to this world, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. It's our reasonable service to give back to one who's given us so much.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
There is no number you could put on the mercy. There's no number you could put on the grace that has been poured out to me and you as Christians here tonight. Day after day after day, we sin and we sin and we sin and we sin. And yet what does God do? He loves and 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 he doesn't stop loving.
Amen.
Why? Because he's exceeding magnifico.
Yes.
What about us? What about our service to him? When you wake up in the morning, the time you lay your head down at night, are you exceeding magnifico for the Lord? When you think about everything Christ has done for us, what are we doing for him? Why is it the world has adapted this philosophy of exceeding magnifico more than we have? Right now is the NBA Finals. You have individuals who are playing for a trophy. That means a hill of beans in the eyes of God. Let me just say that right now. In the eyes of God, it has no eternal importance. Because next year they're going to have to go do it again. Means no eternal importance, and they train for hours and hours, and they make sure they're in the physical shape they need to be in, and they're doing all these different things. Why? Because they want to be exceeding magnifico in what they're doing. Why is it that businessmen and women have gotten it down to be exceeding magnifico in the workplace, but we can't be exceeding magnifico in our devotion life? We can't be exceeding magnifico in the house of God. And we struggle with going soul winning. We struggle with building our bus routes. We struggle with building our Sunday school classes. Why? Because they have it more than we do. What's wrong? We need to get with the program. We need to realize, hey, God is all for exceeding magnifico. Let all things be done decently and in order. We ought to be exceeding magnifico for the cause of Christ. A man named Jeff Bezos, you know, ain't know who he is, started a website business back in 1994. And he named it after the largest river in the world, the Amazon River. And he named it that because he aimed to be the largest bookstore in the world at that time. That was his goal. I want to be the largest bookstore in the world. And he aimed high. For several years, though, the company didn't turn a profit. It recorded its first profit in 2001 when it amassed $5 million. 18 years later, Amazon remains one of the largest corporations in world history. Why? Because he wanted to be exceeding magnificent. Why does the world have it right, but we as Christians don't?
Come on.
In 1923, another man named Walter founded a studio and began operating it with his brother Roy. Within 3 years, they produced 2 movies, and they purchased another studio in Hollywood. Yet pitfalls caused them to almost lose literally everything. It wasn't until a couple years later, 1928, the character we love and know today, Mickey Mouse, was created, and the Disney Empire was born. Disney now owns ESPN and ABC and Marvel and a host of other different things. Why is the world understands what exceeding magnifical is? But we have the Bible, we have the Holy Spirit, we have everything we need, and yet we don't get it. We don't grasp it. We're satisfied with giving God average. We're satisfied with just showing up to church, warming a pew, and leaving again. Don't you think God deserves it? Don't you think God deserves your very best? Let me just say this. If you're sitting here tonight and you don't think God deserves your best, something's wrong with you.
Right.
There's a heart issue. You need to come to an altar tonight.
Exactly.
You need to get that right with God.
Amen.
Because if you get to the point where you think, well, I don't need to give God anything. No, you got it wrong. You need to give God everything.
Right.
Don't you forget, you're bought with a price.
Amen.
Many of you got saved. You don't belong to you. You belong
yes.
to God.
Amen.
And guess what? I thank God I belong to God.
Amen.
I thank God I'm saved by the blood. I thank God for that amazing grace. And I thank God I can give Him everything I have.
Amen.
What are you holding back on tonight? What part of your life you're refusing to give God? You might be giving average. Maybe you're giving good. Maybe you're even giving great. But you're not giving exceeding magnificent. That word magnificent means magnificent. That means you're supposed to give exceeding magnificent. David said, hey, you know what? The house of God is important. I'm going to make sure it's built exceeding magnificent.
Yeah.
What about your life? And about you, when I look at my wife and I look at my son, who's 1 month and 1 year old, you know what? I want my son to have a life that's exceeding magnificent. Our families need to be exceeding magnificent. Our churches need to be exceeding magnificent. Our own personal lives need to be exceeding magnificent. You know why? Because we're ambassadors for Christ. How do we expect to be the proper gospel witness we need to be, even in a clothing store, if we're not exceeding magnificent?
Yeah.
It won't happen. It's a shame. You have Jehovah's Witnesses who are more faithful in spreading their false doctrine than we are as Christians who have the truth. We know the way to heaven. They don't even know it. They believe they're not even going to go there. And yet there they are, knocking on doors more faithful than we are. You know why? They want exceeding magnificent.
Sure they do.
But yet we don't. I'll go for an hour on Saturday. I have other things I got to do. No, that's average. That's below average. What about exceeding magnificent? Yes, it takes work. Oh, that's a foreign word today. Should I park? Let me park it right there for a second.
Yeah, come on.
Work. This generation doesn't know what work is. They want everything given to them. Hey, mom and dad, buy me everything. Give me everything. No. My parents taught me you gotta work for it.
Yeah.
At the age of 12 years old, I worked in my family's deli. Anything I wanted to buy, guess what? I had to earn it. I had to get the money myself. All throughout high school, I was on the basketball team. I was in ministry, and I worked a full-time job at a restaurant. Because my parents instilled in me a work ethic. And I'm glad they did.
Amen.
Work's important.
Sure is.
Go to old hymn of faith. Work, for the night is coming.
Amen.
You know, there's going to come a day. You're not going to have any more time to work.
That's right.
If Jesus Christ were to come right now, are you satisfied with the work you've done for Him? Mm. Are you satisfied if you were to come right this very moment and you were to stand before the King of Kings and you're standing before the Lord of Lords? Are you satisfied with that work? If the answer is no, you got work to do.
Yeah.
While there's still time. I don't know how much time is left. It could be 5 minutes, it could be 5 years, it could be 500, it could be 5,000 years. I have no idea. But we need to work. There's a world out there we need to work and reach. There's things we need to do as the for the cause of Christ. We need to build our house. We need to build our son's classes. Why? Because we need to be exceeding magnifical. Colossians 3, 23 and 24. Whatsoever you do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men. Colossians 3, 17. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. Ecclesiastes 9, 10. Whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. Mm. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest. You get one life. One life, folks. You get one life to give everything. You give God everything you have. There's no reset button. There's no do-over. There's no, God, let me go back and redo that. No. You get one chance.
Right.
And I guarantee you, the mansion God's preparing for you right now, it's exceeding magnificent. You know why? Because John chapter 14 tells me that Jesus Christ Himself is preparing a place for me. He's preparing a place for you. And guess what? I guarantee you that if Jesus Christ is doing it, it's exceeding magnificent.
Yes, amen.
It's about time we as Christians, we wake up and smell the coffee, so to speak. And we start giving God not 20%, not 40%, not 99.9%, but we give God our best. We give Him exceeding magnifical. Hey, you want to see a revival? Start giving God exceeding magnifical. You want to see God do a great work in your family? You want to see God do a great work in your job? You want to see God do a great work wherever it is you go? Give God exceeding magnifical.
Right. Amen.
That's what we need in our churches. We need pews filled with people who are going to give God their very, very, very best they can. Mm. Tonight, if you're not proud of the work you've done thus far, you still have time to get it right. We need to make sure we're exceeding magnificent.
Yes.
You think of everything God's done for you and me. You think of the precious blood that was spilled on Calvary. That's exceeding magnificent. Well, but what about me? I'm 27 years old. About the 27 years I've lived on this earth, am I exceeding magnificent for the cause of Christ? Are you exceeding magnificent? Are you satisfied? If you're not, there's still time. There's still souls that need to be reached. There's still things that need to be done in the church. Pastor White, I'm pretty sure there's things that need to be done in the church all the time. Sunday school class that need to be done, bus routes that need to be driven, things that need to be done. Why? But guess what? We need more people that are going to be exceeding magnifical. And going to say, hey, be like Isaiah, here am I, Lord. Send me. You know what Isaiah was saying? I'll give God everything I have. I'm giving Him my life. Here am I.
Amen.
Send me.
Amen.
That's what your prayer ought to be. That's what my prayer ought to be. We need to give God our best.
Right.
If you're not doing that, folks, you need to stop. Because what if God just stopped giving His best? What if God starts saying, well, I died on the cross, but yeah, that person's not going to get saved. I'm not going to let that person into heaven. I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm not going to do that. No, God doesn't do things average. God does things exceedingly.
Amen.
That's what me and you need to do. We're His witnesses. We're His testimony. We're His ambassadors.
Yeah.
What kind of ambassadors are we who don't start giving God our best? Any job you work here in the world, if you start not giving them your best, and you start slacking off, you'll be fired.
Right.
Why is it okay in the house of God? It ought not to be. Let's start being exceeding magnificent for the cause of Christ.
Yeah,
Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this day and help me to be in your house. God, I thank you, Lord, for your Son, Jesus Christ, and all these things. Lord, help me to be more exceeding magnificent for you. Lord, help us all. Lord, if we're slacking in any way, Lord, I pray that the Holy Spirit will reveal it right now. And we'd be able to do more for you, more than we've ever done. Only because you deserve it. You rightfully deserve our very best. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful verse in your word. Help us to live it and apply it to our lives. Bless the remainder of the service, and bless Brother Harris as he preaches. We ask in your name.
Stand or hit that, I'd close. But of course, if up here at the altar already, it's just put your arm out and let's go. You go to the altar, it's always open. And if God's speaking to you, you go. Slip out of your seat right now, go. Keep playing something else. We're going to give our best for the Lord and do our best for the Lord.
Set that tent up, and the children can sit all underneath this big canopy that's out there, almost like a tent. You stake it down, things like that. It's all staked down. Real nice out there for them. And so, I appreciate having people like Brother Hatfield with tents like that, and wants to be a blessing. And so we got that tomorrow night. Then we have Friday night. We have our dinner right here at 5:30. We have hamburgers, hot dogs, and some things that we'll have. We'll have people sit at the picnic tables that are around the outside perimeter here of the pavilion. And 5:30, we can eat together, and then we'll get right to the service right after we're done with eating at 7 o'clock. And so bring friends to come. Invite folks to come out these next two nights. It has been good so far tonight. Amen. And we're looking forward to tomorrow to see what God has for us. tomorrow night as well, and Friday night. And I'm asking the Lord, I'm lifting my cup up, asking the Lord to fill my cup today.
Amen.
And it already has been full. I want it overflowing. Amen?
Amen.
By the time I leave here tonight, and I'm sure it will be. So let's bow our heads for prayer. Ask God to bless the offering. This offering goes right to helping the needs of this the camp meeting. So let's pray together and ask God to bless it. Brother Trader, would you lead us in prayer?
God, we thank you for tonight. Lord, we thank you for the blessings that was already preached. Be with the next preacher and the singers, Lord. I pray that you fill them with your spirit. Be so great. Bless us all. Let you see for Jesus.
Yeah.
family come to sing to us. We appreciate them being here with us this week, and they have been a tremendous blessing. And then right after that, Brother Harrison will come preach to us. Where's the rest of them? They're coming.
The Lord is good, His mercy endureth forever and ever to all generations. So I will stand up and sing praise, hallelujah, for I know the Lord is good. Puts me on.
Answers for me. another wonderful job. I don't know where you are. I can't see without these here, but I can't see with them out there. What a job. Great message. And boy, we need to be seen magnificent. Calvary answered to me of truth. He did it magnificently. He sure did. Well, I was in a church not too long ago when the pastor said this. He said, now don't shout while the singing's going on and pout while I'm preaching. I like that statement.
Yeah. Amen.
And I heard the English sing, and I'm beginning to see that even on the eastern shore they understand the words, at least anyway. He was singing and he talked about saying, glory!
Yeah. Yes.
That'll work.
Yeah, that'll work.
Amen.
Amen.
And that word amen's a good word.
Amen.
So don't pout during the preaching while you're shouting and singing.
Amen. Amen. Right.
So help me out tonight. I want us to get something from the Word of God. I want you to help people, all right?
Amen.
And if you agree with what we're saying, let us know.
Amen.
Yeah.
Right?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let me ask you this. When you go to a house, and you're a guest, and they put a nice spread out on the table, and you're sitting there eating, you just sit there like a bump on a log, eat it all, and then get up and leave and never say a word to them?
Come on.
What do you usually say while they got that good spread in front of
them?
Man, this is good. Boy, I tell you, good job. I appreciate that. You know what we're putting out here, what this preacher just put out to you?
Yes.
He put the best meal in the world
Amen.
Right out before you.
Amen.
What we ought to be saying is, boy, that's good.
Amen.
I agree with that. Well, what if I'm convicted? Then say amen so nobody knows you're convicted. Amen. 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 Don't let everybody know you're convicted. Just go ahead and say amen like everybody else. And talk to the Lord about it. Hallelujah. All right. Well, just love you tonight. I'm so grateful for the good people here at Bayview. I've watched and observed the hard work of everyone here, and man, people brought chairs out so we could sit. And think about it. Most people in Nehemiah's day stood for over 6 hours.
Yeah.
Stood on their feet.
That's
and
right.
We have a place to sit down.
Amen.
Isn't that blessing? Somebody sacrificed for me these chairs. God bless you for doing that. Brother Hatfield came and put me a light up so I can see. And that's a blessing. Amen. And God turned on the air conditioning tonight.
So amen.
Praise God.
I'm telling you, the Lord is good.
Amen.
Oh, man, what a blessing. I'm glad you're here tonight. And I appreciate you coming and being here this evening, that's for sure. I know some of you have been to work, and it can kind of get a little challenging. I think Hatfield and I were talking last night, by the end of the week, you're going ready to pass out. Anybody else say amen to that?
Yeah.
All right. And praise the Lord. I want you to take your Bibles to three places this evening, and we are going to talk a little bit about the home. But I want to preface it with this and not try to be a false sense of pride. You know, there's two ways you can have pride. You can have pride where you think you're it, and you have that false sense of pride where you just overly crush yourself to the point to where it's really what you're wanting is somebody to say, oh, no, really, you did a good job. You want to hear that. So that's another form of pride. Amen.
Amen.
But I do want to say this. I do not feel that I qualify for the particular subject that I'm going to talk about tonight. When we're talking about the home, I think we've got a lot more years before I can really qualify for this. But by God's grace, with His good word tonight, He qualifies.
Amen.
And so let's listen to the Word of God tonight and allow the Lord to help us a little bit about our home. Can we do that?
Amen.
And young people can get something. We as men and ladies can get something as well. Find these passages of Scripture. Find Joshua 24. Joshua 24. When you find that, we'll read that as our text kind of to start off with this evening. And then I want you to find Hebrews chapter number 11 and Genesis chapter number 4. Hebrews 11 and Genesis chapter number 4. When you find Joshua 24, if you would stand, I want to read probably the most familiar verse of Scripture that there could be in relation to a Christian's home. And that is this. Verse 14, the Bible says, "Now therefore, hear the Lord, and serve Him in sincerity and in truth. And put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord." Then Joshua says, "And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord." Could you imagine anyone thinking that it would be evil to serve the Lord? Can you imagine that? But there was a day you and I was in that place. Well, it was really evil to us. It wasn't something we were interested in. Thank God He saved us and changed
Amen.
That. But He says, "And if it seem evil unto you, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord."
Amen.
I'm interested in serving Him. How about you?
Amen.
But I don't want just me. I want my progeny. I want the legacy to go on in my family, continuing to serve the Lord. And that's what we're really interested in tonight. So by God's grace and with His help, we'll talk a little bit on this subject. He had this testimony. Let's pray. Father, I ask you, oh God, to help us tonight. I thank you for these folks. Some of the ladies, no doubt, are a little chilly. And I pray for them, that you'd help them, comfort them, and give them some warmth tonight so that their minds and hearts could be able to hear. And we as men, maybe we're comfortable. And they being comfortable, tired, we could become dozy and want to go to sleep. Help us, Lord, to listen tonight and be alert and be able to listen to the Word of God and get the principles that you want us to get. And Lord, I just pray tonight for that one that does not know you as Savior. I don't know every heart. And I'm not just going to take it for granted that everybody here is saved. If there is one, oh God, I pray, may they learn about Jesus tonight and come to the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And then, Lord, I pray for us as saints, that you would encourage us, equip us better, and, Lord, use us more effectively. And we'll sure thank you for it. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Here in Joshua, before we get to our other verses that I'd like for you to go to, I want to pull out something for us to get a hold of. Here is what Joshua has pretty much said to the nation of Israel. And he said it under the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. God told him. He said, "I want you to gather the people together and I want you to preach to them." And basically what he has done, Pastor, is he's preaching a message here. He's gone through and he's told them what God has done for you. God sent Moses down to Egypt. And basically he said, "I brought you out." I'm so glad for the day that God brought me out.
Yes. Amen.
Are you?
Amen.
Then he said, "I didn't just bring you out," and I'm glad for that. I'd sure love to preach another message this week on the fact that he didn't just bring us out, he brought us in. Amen. See, that's our God. He doesn't just bring us out and leave us. He brings us somewhere. And he said, "I brought you out and I brought you into a land that's flowing with milk and honey." He said, "I've delivered you. I've delivered you. I've done for you. When the enemy wanted to do something to you, I wouldn't listen to them. I took care of you. I've loved you and I want you and I want to help you," etc., etc. And Joshua said upon this, what I want to say is this: we need to choose to serve the Lord.
Right.
That's what Joshua basically said to them. And our premises, or our bases, if you will, for our service for the Lord ought to be, or ought to hinge upon, what God has done for us. Amen. Let me remind you of this. Not one of us chose to love God.
That's right.
God chose and set His affection upon us, and because of His great love for us, we in turn love Him.
Amen.
Amen. You say, well, I've chosen to do so, but you didn't till God set his affection on you. And so I'm just here to say, we need to understand that God has done some great things, as our preacher said a little while ago, magnificent, some wonderful things that God has done for us. And Joshua says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to understand what God has done for you. He's done for a purpose. And what he wants to do is he wants you to serve him. And then he wants your children, come on, to serve him. And then he wants your grandchildren to serve him. Amen. What he wants is he wants a legacy to continue. Right. A people who will remember that I brought you out, I brought you in, I delivered you, I blessed you, I've helped you, and I want there to be a progeny that continues on that says, I'm going to keep serving God because Dad taught me how to serve God. Amen. And I'm going to keep serving God because Dad and Grandpa, are you getting a hold of what I'm trying to say? And so Joshua says, he said, you just go ahead. You choose what you want to do. But as for me and my house, we will serve
him. Amen.
Now here's an interesting thing, and I'm competing with volume over here, so I'm going to be a little louder. But here's an interesting thing. Those folks said, that's what we're going to do. We're going to serve God.
Amen.
But it is interesting that they made a decision. Here's what I believe. Based on a man rather than the miraculous work of God in their life.
That's right.
Well, how do you know that? Because the Bible says when Joshua died, they strayed from God.
That's right. That's right.
So this is kind of more of a man following than a God following.
Right.
And it was so bad, get a hold of this, that in Joshua chapter number 2 it says, and there arose a generation that knew not God. Now, you're sitting here under the sound of my voice tonight, and you are saying amen, you're smiling, you're showing some type of life in this service tonight, and maybe in your heart you'd say, well, that wouldn't happen to me. That wouldn't happen in my family.
Come on now.
But I would dare say that the nation of Israel, what they've been through and where they're at now, they would have said that won't happen to us. And guess what? It did. And can you imagine just a couple generations down the road to say that there rose a generation? Not just not serving God. Are you with me? Get a hold of this.
Amen.
But knew not God.
Right.
Got so bad that they didn't know who God was.
That's right. Right.
God help us to be careful. Because if we're not, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall.
Amen.
It could be our family. It could be down the one down the road that we're weeping over and saying, man, I wish my grandkids knew the God that I know. I wish my grandkids or great-grandkids were serving God like we have served God. It could be that it is us that's weeping over those. And if it is the case tonight, and I don't know every heart, and I'm certainly not trying to be a judge or look down on anyone. I just want you to know, even if you have children that maybe have turned away from God a little bit, don't give up hope. Don't give up hope. If there's still breath in them, don't give up hope. There is hope that God can bring them back to a place of service for the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm glad we have a God who is gracious in spite of our failures sometimes. Amen. So Joshua says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So there's a choice. This is what I want you to get out of this. There's a choice that was made. Now, to illustrate and to bring to us what I really believe God wants us to get a hold of tonight, I want to illustrate this utilizing two men who had a testimony. Look in the book of Hebrews with me. Hebrews chapter number 11. And we're going to get into this lesson or whatever you want to call it tonight. And I pray that you'll listen and that it'll be a help to you tonight. In Hebrews 11, look at verse number 5. The Bible says, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death and was not found, because God translated him. For before his translation, here it is, he had this testimony that he pleased God.
Amen.
Yes. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. Amen. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them, get this word, that diligently seek him.
Amen.
We've got an idea that we can have a casual relationship with our God, and that will be sufficient to carry on for generations to come. May I say, nowhere in your Bible will you find that it is a casual relationship that God is interested in having with us.
Right.
In fact, he said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice,
yes,
holy, holy, acceptable unto him, which is, as our brother said, your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Can I tell you, beloved, God Almighty, his perfect will for you and for me is to have a testimony that pleases.
Amen.
Now that's one thing, Pastor White, for us to look at each other and say, Brother White, man, I tell you, you got a great testimony. And I believe that.
Amen.
And you could even return the accolade to me and maybe say, but Brother Harris, you have a great testimony.
Amen.
But I'm going to tell you something takes a greater credence.
Sure.
When the very God of heaven says, he had this testimony.
Yeah.
What was that testimony that he pleased me?
Amen.
God in heaven looking at us and saying, that man there, that woman there, that young person there, that child there pleases me.
Yes.
Well, what is the will of God? The will of God is that we please the Father.
Amen.
Well, how do you know that? Because here's what Jesus said. He said, I do always those things which please the Father. You know what he's saying? Just like I do, I want you to do. I want you to do always those things that please the Father.
Amen.
Amen.
Some time ago, there was this saying came out, and I don't even remember where it came from. I'm really not interested in that necessarily. But they made bracelets, they made necklaces, they made shirts. They did everything with Come on, help me. WWJD, something like that. What would Jesus do? What a wonderful thing. But I'll tell you what Jesus would do. He would do those things to please the Father.
Amen.
And may that be our desire. May it not be that, preacher, please don't put constraints on me. Please don't give me rules that I have to live by. Instead, it would be, oh, preacher, could you help me set up a guide? A guide in my life so that I'll stay within the parameters of where God wants me to be, so I can be protected, so I can be blessed by God, so I can be a blessing to others. That's what Abraham said. He wanted to be a blessing to others, and that's exactly what he became. And may I say, ladies and gentlemen, God help us to do always those things that please
Amen.
The Father.
Amen.
And it says of Enoch, Enoch was done, for God took him, but he had this testimony. Now, in order for us to really grab hold of this truth tonight, I want you to go back to Genesis chapter number 4 and 5. Genesis 4 and 5. Who lives there, preacher? Enoch does. Enoch does. Enoch lives in chapter number 5. You'll find him, all of us know this story, in Genesis 5, where it says Enoch walked with God. In fact, it says this. Let me get up here and read it correctly, because I may misquote it, and I don't want to do harm to the precious Word of God. In Genesis chapter number 5, here's what it actually says in verse number 21. And Enoch lived, get a hold of this, 65 years and begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years.
Right.
And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him.
Right.
So here's what we have in a small synopsis of a man on holy writ, that God says, let me just tell you about a man that I think you really need to think upon when you're thinking about your home, when you're thinking about what kind of a parent you ought to be, what kind of a child you ought to be. Let me introduce you to a man on holy writ that can help set some parameters, if you will, in your life so that you can have that kind of a home that God Almighty will say, I'm pleased with that home. They have a testimony that they please God.
Amen.
No. Not that they do what they can to get by.
Right.
But not that they do what they can so that people will say, boy, what a good Christian they are.
Right.
But then, as our brother said, that stepped to a different plane and say, I'm really not interested. I love my pastor. I love my deacons at my church. I love my Sunday school teacher. I love my friends. But oh, I'm going to a higher plane. I'm shooting for a way above those. I'm looking for God to say, he's pleased.
Yeah.
Amen.
He had this testimony that he pleased God. There are two men here that we find. And by way of message tonight, and I've got a lot I'd like to give you, but I'm going to hurry as quick as I can. But I want you to notice, first of all, as we look at Enoch, I want you to notice that the climate in which Enoch lived in was extreme. The climate was extreme. What do you mean? Well, you can have extreme cold, they'll say. Or you can have it extremely, the extreme. Not just in the middle, it was extreme.
Right.
What do you mean? Well, if you go back to Genesis chapter number 4 now, you're going to find that it was extreme, and it is seen in the contemporaries of Enoch's day. Who are the contemporaries of Enoch's day? Well, here you have a man who has been born, he's grown up, he's 65 years old, and now he has a son, and the Bible says that all of a sudden he walks with God. So for 65 years, I'm wondering in my heart, my mind, what was going on in those 65 years. Maybe as Enoch was going along, he faced some difficulties in his life from society.
Yeah.
And it was extreme circumstances. Well, how do you know that? Watch your Bible. Look in Genesis chapter 4 there, and let me help you understand what we're saying. In Genesis 4, the Bible says in verse, let me get it over there, Genesis 4, verse number, come on page, verse number 19. And Lamech took unto him two wives. The name of the one was Ada, the name of the other Zillah, and Ada bare Jabal. He was the father of such as dwell in tents, and of such as have cattle. And his brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all such as handle the harp and organ. And Zillah, she also bare Tubal Cain, an instructor of every artificer in brass and iron. And the sister of Tubal Cain was Naamah. Now, watch this. You get something out of your Bible by Bible definitions in relation to names.
Right.
Do you know what the name Lamech means? Let me tell you what the name Lamech means. Lamech simply means this. It means destroyer. Okay, wait a minute. How's he a destroyer? Watch this. And what I want you to do is draw a parallel here and kind of think about today's time versus here. What's the very very first thing Laban does. He doesn't marry one wife. He marries. In other words, he's destroying what God established as the home ought to be. The marriage is supposed to be between one man and one woman. Amplify that a million times over. But between one man and one woman, is that correct? So you know what Lamech is doing? What's this? He's thumbing his nose in the sight of God, and he's saying, God, I don't care how you set up your system. I don't care what you have to say in your instruction manual. I'm going to live my life the way I want to live my life. I'm going to do what I want to do. And so therefore, he destroyed, in the eyes of his family, marriage.
Wow. Yeah, that's right.
Wait, how do we know it got bad? Well, let's go through the names of these boys. He named his first son was Jabal. What does Jabal mean? Are you listening? It means that which glides away. Which gives us the idea, please don't fall. It gives us, say with me now, it gives the idea of he's destroyed marriage. And now he's had a child. And so he's saying, God, let me help you understand something, God. I'll show you how far I'm willing to go. You said we're supposed to have guidelines in our life. But I'm going to have a son. I'm going to name him, and I'm going to put no restraints on him. You raise children without restraints. You're raising hell on the ground. Amen. I'm not cussing. That's a biblical terminology.
Amen.
You are raising a brat who is going to defy God. Right. So watch this now. Now not only has he destroyed marriage, now he has destroyed the guidelines that God wants us to have in our life, our parameters by which to live our life. I'm pulling out all the stops. My son can do whatever he wants to do. He can live however he wants to live. Nobody's going to finger in his face and say, you're not to do this and you're not to do that. You can't marry here or you can't do this. Hey, my son can do whatever he wants to do. So now he has raised a rebel. Now stay with me. Stay with me.
Yeah.
Are you drawing the parallel? Are you looking to today's society?
Yep.
Are you thinking about what we have today?
Right.
Every man doing whatever he wants to do, whatever's right in his own eyes.
Right.
Huh? So we have this boy. Now watch this. Where does it go from there? The next son that comes on is Jubal. What does Jubal mean? He means that who runs. Well, what is this boy running to? Surely it means that he is running to truth. Not so. He's so worldly, he's in a family who has, here it is, a testimony. What is his testimony? I'm going to destroy anything that God wants to do. I'm going to destroy my son by giving him no restraints in his life. He can be rebellious. He can rebel against God. He doesn't have to listen to anybody if there is a God. And this boy, the Bible says in Proverbs, a fool runneth to destruction.
Right.
Hear this boy. He's left just as his brother. He's able to run into life without any counsel, without any restraints upon his life. He's just running through life, doing whatever he very well pleases, just happy and going along. I mean, he's just enjoying life and singing his song, and he's just happy to do whatever he wants to do. We're finding somebody destroying what God established. Come on, go.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
He's destroying.
Yeah.
He's running. Now watch this. Here's where it really gets good. Oh, well, I don't know if it's good, but it's good for us to learn from. Then he had a son, get a hold of this, whose name, are you ready? Is Tubal-Cain. Well, what does that mean, preacher? Are you ready? He in which dwells confusion. You're not signing on with me. You're not connected yet. Are you? Okay, well, let me help you. We're not going to have God tell us what marriage is going to be defined as. We're going to have marriage. I'm going to destroy all the rules of God. I'm going to do whatever I want to do. He goes on to say in the next passage, we'll get to that in a moment, we will find out that he says, I've killed a man to my wounding. Cain was avenged 7 times, but I shall be. Hey, I'm above God. I'll tell God what kind of judgment will be. I'll be avenged 70 times upon me. So I'm going to exalt myself above God. You know what our society is doing today? They are saying that we are gods and we have the right to make up our own rules, right, do our own thing. And I'm telling you, you have Tubal Cain. You have a society that is totally confused. They can't tell what gender they are. Right. They can't tell what it means to be a man and a woman married together. They have changed. They have changed all that God has said. Come to the end. It's amazing how God does it. Lamech, he names his sons, and watch. Next verse, what's it say? After Tubal Cain. Come on, help me. Read it. And Lamech. You know what he's saying? He started out destroying. He set no bounds. Boys just running wild. Confusion is all in his home. And destruction is his end game. This is the kind of climate that Enoch lived in. Now hang on to this. You have men here that pictures, are you listening? The world. Can I remind you that your Bible says love not the world?
Right.
I said the Bible says love not the world. Neither the things that are in the world.
Amen.
Oh, but come on, preacher. Surely we can play their game and do some of their stuff and it won't hurt just a little bit. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump.
Amen.
That's what Scripture says. Are you hearing me?
Amen. Amen.
Here's a man who pictures the world. How? Watch. They have control of, are you ready? The financial segment of society.
Uh-huh.
If a Christian wants a job, guess where they're going to have to go to get a job?
Oh my.
Tell me.
Yeah.
Just like you did. Just like I did when I pastored, worked 3 jobs. Yeah. You got to go to the world to get a job.
Yeah.
It's not that the Christians own the financial segment of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
The bank institutions, you want to get a loan? You're going to have to go to the world to get along. Now, I'm not saying all that's bad, but watch this. Stay with me, okay? The financial segment of the world is ruled by this man by the name of Lamech, who has set himself up as the power, as the authority of the land. Why? Because the financial segment is ruled. Because the industrial segment is ruled. Right there in your Bible. Because the musical segment is ruled by the world. It's amazing. You can't get a jar of mayonnaise without a thump, 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 thump. Help me. The world works real close together. You can't go to a restaurant, order you a meal and sit in peace and quiet as a Christian and enjoy Christian fellowship without some ungodly music going on above your head. Come on now. I'm telling you the truth. I'm saying that Lamech, he controlled the world. And Enoch is his contemporary. So if Enoch's going to have a job to support his family, guess where he's going to have to go? He's going to have to go to Lamech. What are you saying? Hence, parallel, pressure on the Christian. Well, just miss church. If you're going to work for me, you're going to miss church. If you're going to work for me, then you've got to not be one who will witness about the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Come on. Yeah. Not only do we see it in his contemporaries, we see it in the constraints on him. You can't live that God life here. You just leave that at home. Don't you bring it in your workplace. Now, hey, we can talk about all the other ungodly stuff we want to talk about. We can cuss. We can fuss. We can do all we want to do. But don't you bring God
in
here. Am I making sense?
Yeah.
Here is where Enoch is living. Now I ask you a question. Does it sound familiar?
Absolutely.
Are you living in that kind of society?
Absolutely.
You're not the first one, Enoch. And many after him, hence. But here's the wonderful thing. Not only do we see that the climate was extreme during his day, but watch this. We see the choice that he ensued. What do you mean? Here is what happens. The Bible says that Enoch was 65 years old. Isn't that what it says?
Yes, sir.
And at 65 years old, he comes home from work one day, and he's been ramrodded by this worldly leader into thinking that Christianity is bunk and you don't need that stuff, and has been discouraged and is down in the dumps because what he's faced at work. And he comes home to a choice that he has made. What's that? Miss Enoch comes up and says, honey, babe, no, we're not. Honey, babe, you won't guess what's happening. She's not even showing you. You won't guess what's happening. I'm in the expected way. You remember, we made a choice. We was going to have a family. But can I tell you something? A child is a choice.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? A child is a choice. I'll just go ahead and hit this real quick. Abortion is against God. It's a violation of serious sin against God. Hands that shed innocent blood is a very sinful thing in our society. And they're saying that women have their rights. You had your right when you made your choice.
Come on, man.
I understand the circumstances of different things, but I still don't think that abortion is the answer.
Amen.
Amen. But they made a choice. And now she's in the family way. She's going to have a child. I see Enoch sitting there, and maybe tears are flowing down his cheek. Wow. Did not one, my wife told me, we were expecting this big dude here. And he came out a big dude too. I'm telling you, he was almost ready to go on the defensive line of the Green Bay practice. He came as a baby. Amen. Almost 10. So did you, man. Ticked almost 10 pounds. Hey, woo. I mean, he was ready to line up with his nose tight. But I remember her telling me in her little way that we were going to have a baby. Dear, I'm just seeing it. Stay with me here now. We're going somewhere. I hope this will help you. Fur bone down his cheek. He said, Lord, man, I almost came in today. I almost said, what's the use? Why should I even serve God? I mean, it's a constant battle. But why shouldn't I just be this silent guy and just forget all the law? And he said, oh, no, I'm having a baby. And I've got to make a choice. And here will be my choice. I'm going to walk with God.
Amen.
I've seen Lamech and his testimony destroying all that God is pure and clean and right. I've seen this political leader, this Nancy Pelosi and Nader and these guys, destroy what is right, what is godly, what is the right thing for us to be and to do. I've seen this happen, and oh, God help me, I don't want my son to go the same way that Laban's boys are. I don't want it to be destruction. I want my boy to learn how to walk with God.
Amen.
made a choice to have a child. And he made a choice to serve, to walk with God.
Amen.
But you know what? That kind of choice isn't going to come without some kind of resistance.
Amen.
Just because you're having a child, you're not going to be in the boss limit tomorrow and say, hey, you know what? Hey, we're having a child, so guess what? I'm walking with God. And he's going to say, oh, well, you're having a child. God bless you. I don't think that'd be the name. He didn't say it. He may get a different way, though. Come on.
That's right.
You're still going to face those confrontations. Right. You're going to still get more fights, more fusses. Why? Because you've decided to walk with God.
Amen.
So now he makes a choice to commit himself.
Yes.
Here's where it's at, ladies and gentlemen. He made a choice to commit himself to walk with God. What does that mean? Anybody flown around here? Flown an airplane? Raise your hand up. Anybody flies airplanes? Anybody? Okay. All right. So I'm going to tell you what I have learned. Not that I know, but I'm glad there's pilots who do. Because when I fly, I like those pilots who do. Here's what they do. They do what they call taxiing to the runway. And they'll get to the runway and they'll wait for the radio tower to say you have clearance, watch this now, to take off. So the moment they give them that, man, I'm telling you, you're sitting in that plane all of a sudden. That plane begins to shake, they let off the brake, and that plane heads down that runway. Somewhere down that rubber runway that I don't know where it is, there is a place that they call the point of no return. You either get that plane off the ground or you shut her down right now. In other words, it's a place of commitment. Are you following me?
Yeah.
Beloved, we're living in a day and age just like Enoch lived in. And we've got to get this plane off the ground if our families are going to do right and live for God. And if holiness is going to continue in our society, there's going to have to be a group of people who set their jets, take their plane down that runway, and say, it's no turning back now. It's to the sky we go. Yeah. We're going to walk with God. We're going to live for God. My family's going to know how holy God is. My family's going to know how much God loves us. My family's going to know how much God cares about us. My family's going to know how to talk to God. My family's going to know how wonderful my God is. I don't care what anybody else.
Amen.
Amen.
That's good.
That he is still in charge.
Amen.
Amen.
Get her off the ground. Beloved, dads, moms, everything is against your family. Everything is. Don't look at me that way. Everything is.
Yep, yep.
The only thing you got going for you, Pastor, can I ask you to do something for me? Would you stand for me? Turn around there, face them. Hold that book out there in front of them. That man, that book.
Yeah. Amen.
You better stay in the house of God.
Amen.
Because if you don't, you start missing the house of God.
Yes.
The world will do more damage to you than right. It's ever done before. Amen. But the more you keep your family in the house of God, the more you keep your family around the saints of God, the more you keep your family under the preaching of God's word, the more that this influence of the man of God is upon your children. Are you hearing me? The more likely your children are going to walk with God.
Amen.
Amen.
It's got to be. Thank you, sir. It's got to be that we've got to stay with God's blessings. Make He had this testimony that he walked with God. You know what it says?
Amen.
And that he pleased.
Amen.
I'm almost done. Stay with me. Are we all right, preacher? I'm almost done. Watch this now. The choice that he ensued was the choice of a child, the choice of a cause. His soul is important to me. His study is important to me. His steadiness is important to me. I've got a cause. I'm going to do all that I can to walk with God myself so that my son will grow up in a godly home, know who God is, know what the Word of God is, know what the blessings of God is on a godly home. I'm going to do all I can. I've got a cause.
Amen.
He was committed. Amen. Watch this. The completion by which he exited. I almost said the completion by which he exited was exciting. It had to be.
Yeah, I believe it.
Now, Enoch is in his 300s. Well, yeah, around 300. Yeah, it's 300s. He died at 365, or was gone 365 years. Ooh, that's good. You might know how many days there are in a year. How many? I wonder if God might be trying to tell us if we could read our Bible and pray 365 days a year. Wonder why it was 365 he brought up that he walked with God. I don't know. Just thought I'd throw that in.
Amen.
360 years now, 300 years, he's walking with God. One day the Bible says that he was walking along, and as he's walking with God, he was not. He never went to astronaut school.
Amen.
Never figured out how to make a rocket. But he was not. Well, what's that? Here I am. There I'm gone. One of these days, beloved, you and I, as God's people, if we'll just keep on keeping on, and I'm not saying our salvation is based on our keeping on, we're going to go. But I'm saying to go where we can say he had this testimony that he pleased God. May it be that we're walking along with God, and one day we're on what's not. We're just walking along. We're out of here, man. Quicker than Cape Canaveral has ever seen anything take off. Oh, may it be that God help us to walk with him in our sudden departure. He said, my little children, let's go to First John chapter number 2, quickly. First John chapter number 2, because I'm trying to bring this to a close. First John chapter number 2. First John, come on, Bible, help me here, please, pages. First John chapter number 2. It says in verse number 28, and now little children, abide in him. Abide in him.
Yeah,
that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed when he comes. Oh, may we have a group of dads here tonight that will say to our God, I've already made this commitment, but I'm renewing it tonight. I don't want to be ashamed when you come. I want to have a testimony that he pleased God.
Yeah. Amen.
And it may not be that you're a was not. He may be that you're a did not. You say, what does that mean? Well, see, Christians don't really die. They just fall asleep. It may be that you go to the ground and you're dead not. Not really dead. You're in heaven.
Amen.
But they place your body in the ground. You all right?
Amen.
Here we go. I'm almost done, please. Boy, wouldn't it be great as we did with my father in law to not have a funeral service. Not have a dirge.
Right.
Have a celebration night.
Amen. Amen.
I preached Dad's funeral, his message entitled, what's the name of this?
The value
of a soul. Man, we had a shouting time. That was no sitting around there with us, buddy. We were rejoicing in God. You know why? Dad's more alive than he's ever been.
Amen.
I'm telling you, he was faithful. His dying message was, I want to be faithful to the end. He was preaching and preaching and preaching and preaching. October, what was it? 28th, was it? Or 18th was his last time preaching. January the 18th, we punched him in the ground. I'm saying he was faithful. He was thankful all the way to the end. He's going to stand before God. God's going to open up the book and say, here's a man that had a testimony. He pleased God.
Amen.
So you know what I got to do? I can carry the torch now. Because I want our family. to stay in the same line where we're lost.
Amen.
It's not nothing. Watch this. See, how do you know it made an impact on anybody other than Enoch? See, he had a sudden departure, and I don't know the rest. That's wind moving my notes. Just to say here, there we go. He also, it was sudden, but we see that it was a successful life.
Yeah.
How do you know? Watch this. Oh, this is good. Number one, his son is known as the oldest living person in the Bible. 969 years. So, okay, I'm glad you asked. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be
long.
He must have been one who really honored his dad and understood about his walk with God. And children, I want to tell you, God Almighty is true to his word. You honor your parents, your days will be long on this earth. But if you don't honor your parents, your days will be cut short. Secondly, we have Lamech. He's the grandson of Enoch. Well, what about him? Well, isn't it interesting? He lived, are you ready for this? 777 years upon this earth. Anybody know what the number 7 stands for in the Bible? You have triple perfection. You have a man, oh, Bible, wait a minute. Don't look at me that way. Are you saying he was sinless on this? No. The Bible says, be ye therefore perfect as your Father is perfect. The Bible talks about us being perfect. What is he talking about? He's not talking about sinless perfection. Here's a message I wish I had time to preach someday. But sinless cultivation. In other words, the more that I love God and I grow up, the less I sin, because I cultivate a life that will cause me not to sin as much. Somewhere Lamech got a hold of, I want to be right with God.
That's right.
Amen.
And he stayed right with God.
Amen.
Do you think it's by mistake that he lived 777 years? I don't. I think every word of God is pure. I think there's a reason he told us that. And then, there's Noah. Noah's 500 years, and he begat sons. 5 is the number of grace. And the Bible says that Noah found grace.
Amen.
In the eyes of the Lord.
Amen.
And Noah, here you go, walked with God.
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing?
Amen.
I'm just saying, he had testimony that he pleased God. Now, if you take all of that, you have a picture of Calvary. Now I'm done. See, Enoch, after he began to walk with God on this earth, he was translated. We have a Savior who walked on this earth. But then you have Methuselah, who was the longest living man. Watch this now. And his daddy, or his son, Lamech, died 5 years before he did. So Methuselah would represent civilization as we know it, mankind. Thanks be to God. God's given us what we call a window of grace. Where did it start? Lamech, 777, perfect man. There was a perfect man who walked upon this earth.
Oh, yes.
He lived a perfect life.
Yes.
He died a substitutionary death. Yep. And he went up to glory. 5, here we are in an age of grace that was started by a son who lived a perfect life. At the end of the 5, though Noah comes along, gets aboard the ark, and off they go to a new world. I'm looking for a new world.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. One of these days, I want to have a testimony that he pleased God.
Amen.
Preach on
that. Amen.
me ask you something tonight. Is that your testimony? That you please God? That your testimony that you walk with God? The pianist is going to play here in a minute. But if God spoke to your heart tonight, why don't you come and kneel here at the altar and talk with the Lord? Hey, it's got to start somewhere. You need to start pleasing God tonight. You need to start walking with God tonight. If you're not doing that, then why don't you come and talk to the Lord as God's dealing with you? You come.